Well, I think that that we could start, and therefore I would like to welcome all of us to the first to the first informatics evening in this winter semester, and that's my great pleasure to welcome John Aycock to the soil of the Czech Technical University and of our faculty. You may know John as a professor from Calgary, who is the author of the Springer's book on malware and antiviruses. And now we will have the opportunity to hear a talk which is on old computer games. And I would like to add that there is another book by John, which is to be published by Springer, which is finished and which is on old computer games. So I hope that that we all will enjoy this talk and join this.
Děkuji. Děkuji, dobrý večer. Promiňte, nerozumím česky. That is all the Czech I have learned. I'm sorry. Thank you all for coming. I'm flattered by how many people have come out, especially on the first day of classes. What I'd like to do today is tell you about something I've been working on for the last several years called retro game archaeology. And I would like to begin by telling you a story. Particularly the story of my first computer. And I'm not telling you this because I like to talk about myself. Don't get me wrong, I do like to talk about myself, but that's not why I'm telling you this. This is actually part of the story. So this, for those of you who haven't seen these before, this is a Commodore PET 2001-8. And the 8 stands for 8 kilobytes of memory. That's not a lot. What might not be apparent from this is that this probably weighs as much as I do. The case was made of steel, and you'll notice the input was the cassette drive on the left-hand side, and if you look closely at the keyboard, you'll see that it's a touch typist nightmare. It is very hard to type on this. So, my Commodore PET with 8K of memory. Eventually, I replaced this with an Apple II. And the first game console that I had at home was one of these. So this is a Mattel television. And at this point, if you go to Wikipedia, you can probably figure out my age very, very closely. The Intellivision was known for having some of the worst game controllers ever. And I am pleased to say that it has well earned that reputation, because I bought one recently, and even after 30 years, my hand still cramps playing this thing, because if you see the bumps on the side of the controller over there, that's where the jump is invariably, and those buttons are really hard to press, and so your hand gets very sore after a very short period of time. So it's safe to say that I've been involved with old computer games for quite some time, although when you played them back then, you didn't call them retro computer games. So when I went then to university and studied computer science, I guess informatics, we used these. So some of you may know, this is not a computer. This is what's called a dumb terminal. So it is a keyboard and it is a screen, and it doesn't actually compute anything, it just is a communication device between me typing on the keyboard and some big computer far off in another room. My point is this. All of these devices are very constrained in terms of what they can do. And looking at something like this, so how many of you are studying computer science or informatics? Okay. Excellent. Good choice. Can you imagine doing your assignments on this? So now, our students in computer science work in environments which looks much more like this. Now, I'm exaggerating. This is mission control. But I'm only exaggerating a little. So when I teach first year computer science courses, I have my office hours in the lab where the students work. And so I see them, and they're sitting there, and they have their monitor, and they have another monitor beside it, and then they have their laptop open with access to all human knowledge, and then they have their cell phone out too. And even when the students work in the lowest level course, where they work in the most constrained environment, what our students use now are these things. And some of you I see recognize these. These are Raspberry Pis. So they fit in the palm of your hand if you haven't seen these. I would have brought one, but airport security doesn't like people carrying things that look like this. So I left it at home. But yes, it does fit in the palm of my hand. And the smallest amount of memory you can get on these is 512 megabytes. If you're doing the math, and I'm sure you are, then this is, in the palm of my hand, 65,000 times more memory than I had on my first computer. 65,000 times. Now, you may think that this sounds like the rantings of an old man who's complaining about all these kids. Hey, get off my lawn. But I think something has been lost here. And to explain what we've lost, I would like to turn to the composer Stravinsky. You can read this in French or English. No, I'm just kidding. This actually sounds far too academic. What I'd like to do is talk about this game. So this is Halo 2600, and it is a version of Halo which is made to run on the Atari 2600. And this is what it looks like when you play it. The Master Chief over there on the left-hand side. And this is what it looks like when you are a second away from being killed in the game. Because it's actually very hard to play the game and take a snapshot for a presentation at the same time. The person who made this, his name was Ed Fries. And he was a vice president in Microsoft for Xbox development. And he went on to do something much, much more impressive, which is getting Halo to run on Atari 2600. But what Ed Fries observed, and in this way he agrees with Stravinsky of all people, is that there's this connection between constraint and creativity. So in English, there's an expression, necessity is a mother of invention, and that really sums it all up. So what sort of constraints am I talking about here? Well, it turns out that My Commodore PET with 8 kilobytes of memory was huge. It was huge compared to the Atari 2600. So if you take the amount of memory I had, that 8K, and divide it by 64, you have the amount of memory in the Atari 2600. And there's a very good book by Montfort and Bogos called Racing the Beam, where they look at the Atari 2600 in some detail. But essentially it comes down to this. So pretend that this is your television screen. And the way that the image was rendered back then was you would have this electron beam that would sweep across from left to right. And then it would shut itself off and it would go back to the other side. And it would turn on again and go back to the right side. And it would keep doing this over and over and over again. So it got down to the bottom of the screen. And after the very last line, it would wind its way back up to the top again. 60 times a second. And as it was doing this, as the beam was moving from left to right, what would happen is it would draw the images that you saw on the screen. So this is Pac-Man from the Atari 2600. Now, if you think about programming now, if you think about programming graphic image, what you would do is you would tell the computer, this is what I want the picture to look like. And the computer hardware would take care of it. That didn't happen here. So what would happen is this. So the red dot is the electron beam moving. And because the Atari 2600 had no memory, you couldn't just prepare this image and have the computer hardware show it for you. What you had to do as the programmer was draw each and every line before the electron beam got to that point on the screen. 60 times a second. This was your view of the world. So in effect, this is like, imagine driving down the highway. So you're in your car, you're driving down the highway, and you are building the road in front of your car as you go. That was what programming this machine was like. Okay, so you have constraints like this, and you also have various other constraints. So we have the old slow input and output, we have old slow processors, we have limited memory, these over here, floppy disks for storage, cassette tapes for storage. If you've never experienced loading in a program from cassette tape, you are very lucky. But this was in game terms, from the player end of things. But it turns out that the developers were equally constrained. So when you had a game running on an old computer, an old constrained computer, chances were that the programmer wrote that code on that same old constrained computer. They didn't have better computers that they were using. And for game consoles, the situation wasn't much better. So this down here is a Pitfall, programmed by David Crane. And up here on the right, this is the dumb terminal that David Crane used to program Pitfall. And what I want you to notice is that all there is on there is text, and there's not a lot of it. None of this multiple screens, access to all the world's knowledge. And oftentimes, the programmers, when they were writing games, they would actually have to develop their own tools for doing the programming. So in effect, this is like driving down the highway, building the road in front of you, but first you have to invent the wheel. And yet despite all this, these programmers would be able to produce these games in sometimes amazing amounts of time. This is a particularly infamous example. So this is E.T. for the Atari 2600. Howard Scott Warshaw programmed this from beginning to end in under 6 weeks. That was actually a lot of time. This, on the other hand, is Chase the Chuck Wagon, and the programmer produced this in over a weekend. Imagine doing that. And so, these are not great games, I admit. There were a lot of games that really sucked. But if you think about all the constraints these programmers had to work in, then sometimes even some of these so-called bad games were actually pretty amazing that they worked at all. What I'd like to do now is I'd like to turn to the topic of retro game archaeology. And this is the first version of Tetris. The lag was terrible. So Ian Bogost wrote another book where he was talking about our need for media archaeologists. And so what I started asking myself is, what is a retro game archaeologist? What is retro game archaeology? Well, I would define retro game archaeology in terms of what I would call the three T's. So the ability to understand the tools and the techniques and the technology used in old games and how they were built. And the other part to that is connecting them up and putting them in context. It's not just back then, but also now. So retro game archaeology is not just about saying, yeah, E.T., it did this one thing, and stopping. It's not about that. No, it's about saying that, well, E.T. did this one technique, and so did Raiders of the Lost Ark, and so did Congo Bongo. And I never actually expected, as a postgraduate student, to say the word Congo Bongo in a talk. It's one of those things you don't expect to have. So taking all these three games and looking at what they're doing and saying, well, all these three games are using a particular technique for what's called bank switching. And bank switching, in turn, is a technique for memory management. So this places it in a context in its own time. And the other part to this is putting the context in our time right now. So a lot of these old techniques still have places where they get used. May not be as prominent or in the same places as they once were, but they are still used. And so this technique that these three games are using is actually a technique that is still used in embedded systems, in just-in-time compilation. And so they still have relevance. Which is why it does make sense to do retro game archaeology. Because you might not be taught these things anymore as students in computer science, but they're still used. And it's still good to have more tricks that you can use as a programmer. So if I were a much better academic than I am, then I would be much better dressed, for starters. And I would probably be telling you that history is important. This is why we're going to study these games. But I don't dress more nicely than this, and instead I tend to be a very practical person. So it's not that history is important. I think it is. But what I think is that history goes in cycles. I am still amazed that I found that picture, by the way. That is an awesome picture. Rabbit on bicycle. So yeah, history, it goes in cycles. And so these techniques which these games once used, which we think, oh, we won't need that anymore, because we have so much memory, because it's not as though someone is going to come out with a device that has constraints on it. or the same memory constraints in sensor networks, or the same memory constraints in embedded systems, or the same memory constraints in the Internet of Things. The reason I had come to Prague in the first place was I was attending an antivirus conference, and they are really worried about the Internet of Things. So all these topics that were discarded, that went by the wayside, these are still important. They're still important now. And this is actually a really good time to be doing this sort of work. So for me in Canada, the copyright law changed because all these old games, they are still copyrighted, but you run into problems in that the companies disappeared 20 years ago and no one knows who owns the copyright anymore. And so for me to actually teach about this, this is a problem because I'm supposed to be abiding by copyright laws. So the Canadian law changed quite recently, and for the first time it actually gave exemptions for education. And so for the first time I can actually teach about this stuff in the classroom without being worried about lawyers coming and knocking on my door. And in the United States, the Internet Archive has done some amazing things. So they got some exemptions to United States copyright law, which allows them to archive all sorts of old software. And if you have not been to their website, they have not only saved it, they have made it so you can play it in your web browser. Thousands of games that you can play in your web browser. How many of you have tried this? If you haven't, you must. Do it now, before you get busy with the rest of the term, because essentially a week of your life will be gone. But I do want to be clear. So retro game archaeology is not just about playing old games. It's about looking at how they were built, how they were implemented. And the examples that I use when I do this research, they're not the best, they are not the most influential. I'm not a game historian. And some of these examples of particular implementation techniques are actually very rare. So when you find one, it's like you found a unicorn. So if you found one of these examples and you said, I found this example, but it's not in Pac-Man. It's like saying, I found a unicorn and getting mad because it throws up on your shoes. It's a unicorn! How many times are you going to see one of these? Perhaps the most sobering reason, though, why this is actually a really good time to be doing retro game archaeology is the people who created these are not young programmers anymore. And there's been a number of times over the last few years where I've wanted to contact someone and they have died a few years ago. And so any knowledge that they had about their games or how they were created is gone. Because a lot of this is simply not recorded. And so this is actually a really good time to be doing this. And some of these people have been amazingly helpful. Email them an innocent question, you'll get this big long email back with all these random details that they remember because they're so happy someone has asked about this after 30 years. Okay, so now you know what retro game archaeology is, why you might want to do it. And what I'd like to do is lead you through the process of how this works. So the first step in this is choosing a game to study. So one method is sort of a traditional research methodology, by which I mean Google. And it turns out that there's lots of people around the world who have spent lots and lots of time studying their favorite games. And it makes sense to actually take advantage of this. So, for example, during one part of this, I wanted examples of games that use a particular data compression technique called run length encoding. So, with a few extra search terms, I pop this into Google, come up with some random person's blog. No idea who this person is. And he says, yeah, I think this game Spookhouse used run length encoding. Like, okay, I've never heard of this game before. So, I'm done. Or am I? No, because it turns out that as a researcher, you always want to find a primary source. And this fellow, I'm sure some of you remember him, US president during the 1980s, and he had this saying, trust but verify. And so it's great when you find a tip like this, which says, yeah, I think this game does that. But the ultimate authority is the game code itself. And so it's not enough to say, yeah, I think this has it. You actually have to look at that game code and verify that it's actually there. So that's one method. Google, Wikipedia, all the traditional places. So another approach is where you have a rough idea of what you're looking for. So sometimes, for me, this has been a vague tip. So I had contacted David Crane, the guy who wrote Pitfall, and he said, yeah, I think some games were doing this particular trick with memory. He couldn't remember which ones. And so what I did is I set up my software emulator to jump up and down and make lots of noise if it found this trick being used. And then what I started doing is I started playing through one game after the other until the emulator told me, hey, you found an example of this. And I was doing this a bit more recently. I was looking for a particular type of copy protection that I thought for sure had to be used on Atari 400 and 800 computers. No idea if it was actually done or which games might have done it. So again, I set up my software to say, okay, let me know if this happens. And then I just started playing through a bunch of games. And so yeah, finally found three, started looking at the code and said, okay, pole position, that's the one I want to use. Now another source, turns out, I don't know if there are any Czech language translations of this, but there are actually two English magazines devoted to old computer games. I guess there's a market for it. And they will have interviews with all these old programmers, and sometimes you'll be reading along with this interview and there'll be one sentence in there, and the programmer will mention something in passing about, oh yeah, I remember we did this particular trick in the game. It's like, that's what I want. So I'm done. Or not. So yes, that's when I have to go back in and find the game and actually verify that they are doing what they thought they were, because it's been 25, 30, 35 years in some of these cases. I can't remember what I had for dinner last night. So yes, people's memories fade. And I apologize because I realized after I made these slides how completely inappropriate it was to have a picture of Reagan right beside memories fading. So, sorry, that was an accident. So the last method that I've used to pick games is actually just questions that I've had when I've been playing these things. So for example, I know that Pitfall on the Atari 2600 was using a particular method to produce its jungle scenes. And when I bought that Intellivision, I got the game Pitfall for it too, and I started playing through this and I started thinking, this seems an awful lot like the Atari 2600 version. an awful lot like the Atari 2600 version. And so I started thinking, are they using the same technique in the Intellivision version as they were in the Atari version to produce the jungle? So just something that I was curious about. Or in the bottom, it's a bit hard to see, but you might be able to see a multicolored field right there. That's Yar's Revenge. And it is actually, after 30 years, it's still a really good game. So if you haven't played it, it is worth trying. And then I was playing this other one, which is not nearly as good, called Laser Gates. And you notice there's multicolored fields. And so I asked myself, are they using the same technique to produce those multiple colors as Yar's Revenge was? And over here, I had bought myself a used Nintendo Entertainment System, and I was playing through around Christmas time. And I was playing through this level, and I thought, gee, I wonder how the game stores the data for this level. And there went my entire Christmas. The answers, if you're wondering, are yes, yes, and it's complicated. Okay, so that's the first step, is you need to choose something to study, just like you do with any research. So the next step is you need to actually acquire the thing that you want to study. You need to get hold of it so you can study it. So you need to find the image. It might be a floppy image or a tape image. Sometimes you can buy these off eBay. I spent entirely too much money buying things off eBay. There is also a website called GOG.com. It used to stand for Good Old Games. So if you're interested in old DOS games, you can actually buy a lot of them from there. Usually it comes down to, I'll admit it, Russian websites. And but there's a Canadian copyright exemption now, so it's good. Sometimes, if you're really, really lucky, you will find source code, but that's very rare. So that's the next step, is you need to get a hold of the game. And then you actually need to run the game. And sometimes this has simply not been possible. There's some platforms that are too strange, that are too old, that are too obscure, that you just can't get the thing up and running. In any case, you don't want to run this on real hardware if you're studying it. So real hardware is not your friend. What you want is you want to have this godlike view of what the game is doing. And so what you want is you want a really, really good emulator. Emulators are your friend, especially if they have really good debuggers. Now this is an Atari 2600 emulator called Stella, and it has the most awesome debugger, because it actually shows you the entire state of the machine. And if you look there in the upper right, you see this grid of numbers. That is all of the Atari 2600 memory. It had so little memory, it could show you all of it at one time. So emulators are your friend. At the same time, it's what you would call a love-hate relationship, because emulators really suck. Oh God, they really suck. Right now, I have 4 emulators for the Apple II installed, because all of them do slightly different things, and all of them will maybe emulate one disk format and not another, or won't emulate a certain thing properly, so you need to run it in yet another emulator. So 4 Apple II emulators, just to do this work. And in, Playing Hunt the ROM. That is a really fun game. Again, it comes back to the Russian websites, because when you want to start up a new system in the emulator, it requires the ROMs, which you don't have, and then you need to track them down. And the emulator, of course, doesn't bother telling you what it's looking for. It just says, I can't start. And so you start getting these ROMs and you start installing them and running it, and it says, I can't start. And you get more ROMs, and you drop them into place, and you try it again, and it says, I still can't start. It's like, give me a hint, you know what you're looking for. So yeah, it's a really fun game. I highly recommend it. But ultimately, for some parts of this research, these emulators are not designed for this task. And some of them don't give you the sort of view you might want into these games. And sometimes what you need to do is you need to actually either, I've had to modify emulators to get the information out, or take the information out of the emulator and view it in some different way. Let me show you what. So this is a trace of a game for the Texas Instruments 99-4A called Parsec. And this particular computer has a graphics chip on it, which has memory. But you can only see it through a single address. So it's very difficult from the emulator's debugger to actually figure out what's happening in this graphics chip. So what I did is I took the data and displayed it this way. So what you're seeing down at the bottom is all the graphics memory. And up at the top, this is the image that the game would be displaying, because what I wanted to figure out is how it was scrolling so quickly, because it was scrolling that background much faster than that computer should have been able to do. And with this visualization, I was actually able to look inside into the graphics memory and see what was happening and how pieces were shifting around. And if you're wondering how big that was, Jan was showing me that you actually have a similar facility here. This is in our library. We have an entire display wall in a visualization studio. So this thing was essentially taller than I was. But it's really cool. Okay, so at this point, you've decided what you want to study, what game you want to look at. You set up all the software, you've gotten a copy of the game. I haven't even started doing the work. This is all just leading up to it. So there's a number of things that you can look at in these old games. And one of them is the game code. Now, it doesn't really make sense for most games to actually analyze all of the code, because for any given game, there's lots of code that is really the same, it's boring. I mean, for those of you in computer science, think of the programs you write. There's a lot of infrastructure which is really the same from one program to another. Yeah, doesn't really make a lot of sense to analyze all that. So instead, what I do is I start off with a question. I want to find out how this background is scrolling, or I want to find out what's making the colors in this force field. Okay, so I start off with a single question, and that gives me a guide as to what I want to look at in the code. Sometimes I get surprised. Sometimes you see things that you hadn't expected. And there's really two ways you can go about analyzing. One is by a static analysis, where you look at the code, you don't run it, and try and figure out what it does. And so, do any of you study computer security? Okay, if you do, this is really classic reverse engineering. So you have static analysis, and if you haven't done this, this is like trying to solve a jigsaw puzzle. Okay, you have all the pieces, you have to figure out how they fit together. Dynamic analysis, on the other hand, is where the game is running and you're watching its behavior and trying to figure out what it does. So dynamic analysis is like trying to solve a jigsaw puzzle where all the pieces can move around and can change shape at any time. And it turns out that there's lots of variation in all these platforms. So if you go back to the 1970s and 1980s and you look at old computer magazines, which I encourage you to do, the Internet Archive has a bunch of them, go back and look at the advertisements. Because when you go back and look at these, what you'll find is that there is a huge amount of variety in the computers. It wasn't clear that Apple was going to succeed or that Microsoft was going to succeed. So there are all these different computers. And so when you study code, it's not enough to say, I know 6502 assembly language. Because the 6502 is used in a whole bunch of platforms, all of these in fact, and many more. But if you looked at 6502 code for the same game for one of these platforms and you compared it to another platform, it would look very, very different. Because all the graphics code, all the sound code, all the interface code was different from one machine to another. And so this is really the first thing you have to do when you're studying on a new platform is you have to say, all right, which are the magic regions where the graphics are located? Because you'll see the game code and it'll be very busy doing something in this one region of memory. And you think, that's strange. And then you start digging up the technical manuals and you say, oh, that's because that's where the graphics was. It's doing something with the screen. So this is one thing you could do, is you could look at the code. And the other thing you could analyze is the data in the game. So you might be interested in how the data is stored, how it's used to produce the parts of the game. And this is really what you'd start off with, is a hex dump of the game code. I'll give you a hint. This is the level, the first level from the game Load Runner. Can you see the pattern? But that's the cool thing. When you do see the pattern, it's just like turning on a switch. It pops out at you all of a sudden. And so once you realize that these repeated one values correspond to the platforms in the game, then all of a sudden you can start decoding the rest of it. And sometimes it's useful to figure out, as a programmer, how you would write the code. So this is the data for the first image of a game called Mystery House, which was put out in 1980 by Sierra Online. And I took a while to try and figure this one out. And then finally I said, well, okay, how would I have written that same code? Because I'm lazy. How would I have done that? And sure enough, they were lazy too. Because there are certain values in here, and that became the key to decoding all the rest of it. And you can actually, when you have hypotheses about how these games work, you can go into the emulator and you can test these out as the game's running. So you can start off, so let's say here with Pitfall. And this is using the MES debugger, which is more text-based. And so what I was doing here is I wanted to verify that I understood how the jungle scenery was being generated. So I went in and I changed one value, and then I started playing the game again, went to the next screen, and okay, that was what I expected to see. Okay, so you can make these hypotheses, you can test them out and see if you're right. But there are some games that it becomes too complicated to perform this sort of a task. So it's not just a matter of changing one little byte here or one little byte there. And so I've used this technique I call injection. And what I do is if I have some complicated game data that I want to test my understanding of, I will actually overlay my own code on top of it, my own data, and then start up the game again to see if it behaves how I expected it to. So this here is actually an interpreter for a text adventure game. A bunch of text adventures are put out by the UK company Level 9. And I was trying to understand how their virtual machine was working for the interpreter. So what I did is I created some code, and because the game format was too complicated, I just went right on top and said, here, instead of playing this game, why don't you compute prime numbers for me? And so that's what you're seeing, is this text adventure game computing prime numbers. And this is another one. So back to Super Mario, I said it was complicated. It was actually too complicated for me to do simple tests. So what I did is I wrote some code which would allow me to create my own levels and put them over top of the first level of Super Mario. So, has anyone in this room not played Super Mario? Apart from your dean.
What would you expect?
So, you're probably all familiar with the classic original level, but I guarantee you have not seen this level. So this is my test, and what I did is I created this test to verify that I understood what all the different encodings of all the different blocks in the level were. So as levels go, it's not a good one. But all these things I just placed so I would understand how the game was interpreting its data. And I forgot to put a flag in at the end so you can actually run. So this is another technique that I've used to test my understanding of games. And another approach is to create new old games. So there are a number of text adventure games that would use the same engine to interpret them. And so for me, trying to understand how these engines worked, what I would do is I would create new games for these old engines. So this is a text adventure game I call the telephone booth game. And it is probably, without a doubt, the worst text adventure game you would ever play. Because it's you, and you're in a telephone booth, and there's a phone. And that's really it. But in terms of actually testing these game systems, what that means is that you're in a phone booth, so you have a place. So you have a location, you have an object to interact with, which is the phone, and you can look at the phone and you can interact with it in various ways. So what I've been able to do is I've created this game in a whole bunch of these different text adventure systems, so I can actually compare how expressive they were in terms of how you wrote these games. Now I showed you one visualization already, and this is actually, for tough cases, this is the way that you can understand what the code is doing. So sometimes you know what code is producing an effect you're interested in, but you just haven't quite figured out how. And so sometimes it's actually easier to take the data and visualize it in some way, or even take the code and convert it into another language, and then run that code with some instrumentation to show you what's going on. That doesn't have to be pretty. So this is a dungeon crawler game, and what I was trying to figure out is how it was actually creating the dungeon levels. So what this is showing me here in a very ugly way is a lot of information about how it's set up the rooms, how it's connecting the passages between the rooms. And so what this is doing is it's actually stepping through the algorithm as it's running. And if you see that question mark flashing around, that's the algorithm probing to find when it has a new room that it can connect to. And that was the part I was having trouble figuring out, because it was written in a very strange way in the code. And so I was having trouble figuring it out, but as soon as I saw it and saw it, oh, I see what it's doing, it's just probing. And as soon as I saw that, I was able to figure it out. So that's one example. This is another one. So this is one of the first full motion video games on CD-ROM called The Seventh Guest. And what I wanted to do is I wanted to figure out how the video images were stored, because these are made on the very first CD-ROM drives, which did not move quickly, but yet they had to transfer all this video data on a very narrow pipe to the computer, which didn't have a lot of processing power to actually decode this. And I wanted to figure out how it was doing it. So this is a visualization of the video data for one of the scenes. And what I found really amazing was that I thought this would be really noisy data, but yet you can actually see that these are the figures moving around. And you can probably see that they're not very good at acting. It's very melodramatic. So what the red is showing you is the fact that a particular square in the video changed in that video frame. The green arrows are just tapping to the right position. And the white was, it's changing over the entire span of the video. And so that was actually the trick. Just let me play this again briefly. So this is actually the trick, is how they got that video from the CD-ROM to the computer and decoded so efficiently, was that if you actually look at the changes on any given frame, the red parts, there's not that much of them. And so the actual amount it needed to send was actually a very little amount of data. So I'll just show you one more. So one of the things that I study is the copy protection used in old computer games. And as programmers now, you would be probably very surprised at the low-level access you had to the hardware of the computer. So literally on the Apple II disk drives, you could control where the head of the disk was moving, you could control how it moved from track to track, and you could control all the reading and writing to the extent that if you got the instruction sequence wrong, it just wouldn't work because you had to count the number of machine cycles in order to get the accesses right for reading and writing. You're very fortunate you don't have to do that anymore. So what this represents is the spinning disk. The black line there is the disk head that would actually do the reading. And this is another example where I took some data from an emulator and recorded how the disk head was moving in the emulator, because what I wanted to do is I wanted to see this as opposed to just a string of numbers. So this is the booting sequence for LoadRunner on the Apple II. There were the squares up in the upper left-hand corner there. Those are the phase motors which controlled where the head was positioned between tracks. And so you can see it moving between tracks and reading. And the copy protection was actually based on the fact that it was actually moving not between whole tracks, but between half tracks. But it becomes very visual once you start doing it this way. If you want to play through some more of these, I have a bunch of the animations at that URL. And that last section is actually sort of funny because to save money, a lot of these computers didn't put a lot of hardware, and so if they could save a chip, then they would do so and just push the work off onto programmers. So when these drives booted, they didn't actually have hardware to let them know where the disk head was on the disk surface. And so the way that the Apple II drives figured it out is when you booted the disk, you would actually take the head and it would move it further and further out until it got to the edge of the disk. And then it would keep moving further still and it would beat the head against the side. And you can probably find a video on YouTube of an Apple II booting, and it has a very distinct clattering noise. So it makes this clattering sound because it's beating the head against the outside, because once it does that, it says, okay, I know where I am now. And then it could access the disk. Okay, so visualization is about understanding what the code or the data might be doing. The flip side to that is reconstruction. And that's where I think I know what's going on, but I'm not 100% sure. And so what I do is I write my own code to rebuild the data in the game. And if what I end up with is what the game is showing me, then I'm pretty sure I got it right. And again, it doesn't need to be pretty. So this is a representation of the first level of LoadRunner. And I wrote this program to go through all the load runner levels and dump out what they look like in text. So here, down at the bottom, these Bs are actually the blocks of the bottom platform. And this actually corresponds to the data I showed you earlier. The mystery house data I showed you before draws this scene right here. And yes, the graphics were that bad. The game was not much better. But what I was able to do by writing my own code to do this is, first of all, I could extract out all the images in the game without having to suffer through playing it. And the other thing is I could verify that I had actually gotten the data format correct. It doesn't have to be black and white either. This is from a game called The Hobbit. And this is perhaps one of the most annoying ones I've reverse engineered so far. This was another one on that Texas Instruments machine I told you about, where the graphics memory was sort of hidden away through this one little portal. I still don't know how the code is producing these. I really don't. The code was so convoluted. And it was actually moving. So the CPU could not execute code that was in the graphics memory, but yet the program kept putting addresses into the graphics memory and then extracting them out later and jumping to those addresses. It was so bizarre. So in the end, it was actually easier to attack the data format and just simply reverse engineer what it was doing. This is the final screen to that game, which again is way easier than playing it. So my background is varied as a researcher. So now, besides these old computer games, I'm actually a computer security researcher. And before that, which is actually how I met Jan in the first place, was years ago when we were both postgraduate students, and I was studying programming languages and compilers. And so this is all really great experience because I've had to write all sorts of tools that draw on this experience to analyze these games. So disassemblers, I have a better strings program, so I wanted to find all the printable English strings in Atari 2600 games, even if they had been encoded in weird ways. And so I had so much noise, I actually built a better strings program to filter out all this noise for myself automatically. And then, any of you used pretty printers? Code reformatters? I mentioned you don't usually get game source code. And sometimes when you do, you wish you hadn't. This is actually some of the game source for the game Elite. It was on, this particular version was on the BBC. And they had this odd mixture on the BBC of BASIC and assembly language. And to save space, they didn't do things like use comments or have long variable names. And so this is literally an excerpt from the source code. If you're one of the people in here who isn't a programmer, this might look like garbage to you. And if you are a programmer, this looks like garbage. So what I ended up doing is I wrote a pretty printer to reformat this. And if you're a programmer, you can probably see that it's a little bit more understandable. So, what can I conclude from all this? Well, what I have found over the last few years is that looking at how these old computer games worked, this was actually, first of all, from their point of view, it was really amazing what they did. They were masters of what they accomplished. And I'm, as a programmer myself, I'm very humbled looking at all the things that they did and the constraints that they worked under, and that they were able to make these games work at all. And looking into them and finding out this information as to how they work, it's actually a very hard technical task and very, very challenging. And so if you are in security, I've actually, at the conference, I was talking with a lot of people, and they got their start in security and the antivirus industry because they were interested in breaking copy protection on these old games years ago. A lot of people got their start that way. But the other thing is that all these techniques are still valuable. So you might think, oh, this was just stuff they did back decades ago before I was born. But you know what? You still use these things now. They still have applications now. And this is really a sweet spot in computing history, because if you study the history of the Czech Republic, then a lot of the interesting people that you would want to talk to are not here anymore, for one reason or another. It was hundreds of years ago, perhaps. But with retro games, many of these people are still here. They're still around. We can still hear their stories. So really, the time is now. Thank you very much.
Some time for questions and I hope answers. So you have.
I only have a few answers.
Yes. So questions? Questions, remarks, ideas.
What do you think is the future of gaming archaeology? Because now present games have a lot of the code, you know, on the server side. So you will not be able to access this code or anything in the future.
Actually, so for modern games, this is actually a huge problem. And it's not just server side, but a lot of the community. So if you think about online games, so studying World of Warcraft 20 years from now, there's no one there. And so even if all this technology is still running, you still won't see how people interacted with the game. And game companies are very reluctant to actually let this information be archived. And so this is a huge problem. Fortunately, it's not one that I'm looking at, because I don't envy the people who have to deal with this. Actually, I'll put on this, because copy protection is actually a very difficult problem. So it's not just about getting access to the objects and what's happening on the server side. But if you think about it, all these games that are preserved, these were games that were sold. So in other words, they wanted to make a lot of copies 30 years ago and distribute them as far and wide as possible. But if you compare this to one of the really interesting things, and that is the game's source code, no one wanted to distribute it. In many cases, it's been lost, or it's stored on media that simply degrades over time. So as you may or may not know, if you look at magnetic media like floppy disks, like cassette tapes, it degrades over time and eventually becomes unreadable. And really, for a lot of these things, it's a race against time to try and record all the information on this in some form that we can still access it. And there's been a lot of efforts recently. He posts on Twitter, but he also has a bunch of his work in the Internet Archive. But there is a modern-day person who has decided to crack as many of these old Apple II computer programs as he possibly can. And he's done over 300 now. It's amazing. But when he cracks these, he actually not only cracks it, but he records all the steps he goes through. So you can actually step through his notes and you can see his notes, her notes. You don't actually know who it is, but you can actually see the steps they went through and all the details of the copy protection. So, but I mean, there, it's really the limits in that case of how long this media lasts, and much less what you're talking about, which is where you don't even have access to it in the first place. So yeah, preservation is a really tough problem. I have no good answers, or I'd be very rich.
Well, are there any further questions, please?
What was the strangest or cleverest hack you discovered to get around some constraints, such as small memory or something like that?
The strangest or cleverest hack? That's a good question. There are really so many. One of the most surprising things I found is, so the Atari 2600, I said, does not have much memory. So it has 128 bytes of memory. And I think perhaps the thing that surprised me the most was those early examples I showed, because to actually do some techniques like bank switching or to make some of the games run fast enough for particular screens, they actually used this memory, which was precious like gold, and they would not use it for data, but they would copy code into it. And they would, because the code was faster running out of that memory than it was running out of the ROM. And that was actually why that parsec code on the TI-99/4A was actually running so fast, is again because it had this very small precious area of memory. And it used it to copy some very time-intensive loops into that memory, because they ran fast enough there, and you can actually have timed it. You can actually know there's a measurable difference if you run that code from the RAM as opposed to the ROM. So I think that's one of the more surprising things, is that they had repurposed these precious resources in very creative ways. And some games like Pitfall got around things by not storing stuff at all. And they were some very early adopters of what we now recognize as what's called procedural code generation, or procedural content generation, sorry. Lots of games now use it in much more elaborate ways, but that was how they were able to fit a lot of these very elaborate games into such a small space, because they simply didn't store stuff. And so you have to imagine, so Pitfall was a 4K ROM. It had 128 bytes of RAM to use. It had to contend with producing the screen. It was racing the electron beam to produce what you saw. And then in addition to that, it was using some of this slow CPU computing power to produce the background as you were going from screen to screen. It's a brilliant piece of code. So I think those are the most surprising ones. And yeah, as Jan said, I've just finished a book about this. Springer will charge too much. So if you pause the cameras for a second, you should use the version that will invariably get ripped off and put on the internet, because you're students and you should use the cheap version. I'm fine with that.
Well, other question?
Could you tell any specific applications of the knowledge you gather from studying old games in modern applications?
Yes. So how are these things used? So I didn't really get into this, but so for instance, I don't know how much you study interpreter technology, for example, when you go through computer science here. But certainly there are lots and lots and lots of different types of interpreters using many different architectures that were used in some of these old games, particularly text adventures. And interpreters are still tools that are used if you use Python, for instance, you're using an interpreter. So yes, interpreters are used, data compression is still widely used, and this is something that a lot of these games were making extensive use of, just to fit things into the amount of memory they had. So you have data compression, memory management, both dealing with not enough memory, which is the obvious one, but also too much memory. So sometimes they had more memory they could address than the CPU allowed them to access all at once. And so they had to do to switch banks or other techniques in order to actually get access to all of this. So memory management, data compression, interpreters, what am I forgetting? Copy protection. In fact, a lot of the copy protection has overlaps in terms of computer security, in terms of how you would authenticate users to the system. Because essentially what they are asking with copy protection is, prove to me that you are authorized to run this copy of this game. And so a lot of the techniques have overlaps with what we do with computer security now. Or code optimization and code obfuscation, which is still used often in malicious software more than legitimate software. Although I'm sure all of you have that one friend who writes really nasty code and they just do it naturally, but yes. Code obfuscation is still extensively used in malicious software to try and make it difficult to analyze. So there's actually lots of overlaps with security and computer systems and programming languages, even if you don't get into all the things that were happening with the graphics.
Well, are there any further questions? If no, I would like to thank to John again, and we are in connection, so if you have further questions that you will, that would came to your mind, you can contact us or you can write to John directly. You can see a clever, smart boy who is willing to answer. Well, so thank you.